A volumetric efficiency, or VE map, is something that you'll find inside pretty much every modern ECU or engine control unit. Doesn't matter if it's aftermarket or OEM, it's in there. And it is probably the single most important thing which determines how well your engine operates and how much power it makes in all sorts of different operating conditions and scenarios. But what's also really interesting is that this map is a really good teacher. And that is because, although it doesn't seem that way upon first glance, it's just a map, but within itself, this map contains all the fundamentals of engine operation. How an engine works, it is reflected in this map. And it doesn't matter if the engine is a car, motorcycle, or truck engine, the essence of internal combustion engines is almost always pretty much the same. And it is contained within this map. So if you understand this map, you understand engines. And in today's video, we'll explain what is volumetric efficiency, we'll explain how this map works and why it's so useful, and finally we'll do a practical tuning session to demonstrate how you can tune this map yourself. A VE map has two axes. Our vertical axis is engine hold. In most cases, engine hold is represented by MAP, or manifold absolute pressure. It is simply the air pressure inside your intake manifold. This data comes to the ECU from the MAP sensor, which is located somewhere on your intake manifold, and it measures the pressure inside it. Our horizontal axis is engine RPM, or rotations per minute. This data can come to the ECU from something like a crankshaft position sensor, which counts the number of engine revolutions and sends the data to the ECU. Alternatively, the data can also come from something like an ignition coil. The ECU registers the number of times the ignition coil fires, and based on this, it can calculate engine RPM. Now, at idle and other reduced load scenarios, we have vacuum inside the engine. In other words, the air pressure inside the intake manifold is lower than the air pressure in the atmosphere outside the engine. This occurs because the throttle plate is almost fully closed, and it's only letting in tiny little amounts of air into the intake manifold. But at the same time, the engine is running, and the downward motion of the pistons is creating a void or absence of air above the piston. Air from the intake manifold quickly rushes into the engine to fill that void, and then that same air is mixed with fuel, compressed, burned, and expelled out the engine as exhaust gas. In other words, we are consuming the air. The issue is that we are consuming more air than the throttle plate is letting into the intake manifold. So what happens is that inside the intake manifold, a unit of volume such as a cubic inch or cubic centimeter of air actually contains less molecules of air than that same cubic inch or centimeter of air outside the engine in the atmosphere. Because we have less molecules of air, we have less air pressure. And we call that a vacuum, although the vacuum inside the intake manifold isn't true vacuum. True vacuum would be a complete absence of air. Instead, we don't have that in the intake manifold. We have something that could be called negative pressure because it is air pressure reduced in comparison to the air pressure of the atmosphere. Now, as the throttle plate opens more and more outside air is allowed into the intake manifold. In other words, we're allowing the atmosphere to enter the intake manifold. And of course, because the engine cannot consume the entire atmosphere, pressure inside the intake manifold at fully open throttle becomes equal to atmospheric pressure outside the engine. The pressure equalizes because we have removed the barrier between the atmosphere and the intake manifold. We open the throttle body. Now, a naturally aspirated engine is called naturally aspirated because it relies on nature, the pressure of Earth's atmosphere, to push air into the engine. A naturally aspirated engine can never achieve significantly higher manifold pressure than the air pressure in the atmosphere, which is 14.7 psi if you're at sea level and a bit lower if you're at a higher elevation. And that's why a naturally aspirated engine is going to be limited to about this part of the VE map. And this zero at this part tells us that there's zero difference between air pressure inside the engine and outside the engine in the atmosphere. Now, a boosted engine, an engine with a force induction device such as a turbo or a supercharger, can achieve significantly higher manifold air pressure than would be possible by relying on atmosphere alone. And that's because a turbo or a supercharger sucks in air, compresses it, and stuffs more air into the same volume. Because we have more air in the same volume than would be possible by relying on atmospheric pressure alone, pressure increases well beyond atmospheric pressure. But the beauty of a VE map is that we can use the same VE map to successfully control both naturally aspirated and boosted engines. And that's because VE maps capture the essence of engine operation. We could also display our vertical axis like this. Instead of zero, we put 14.7 psi or 1 bar, which is atmospheric air pressure. Everything below that is now vacuum, and the lowest value would be around 3 psi, and highest value is now around 50 psi. But most aftermarket ECUs choose to display atmospheric pressure as zero. And that's because atmospheric air pressure is a constant. We can't do anything about it, and we're using it as our reference to see what the engine can add on top or remove from atmospheric air pressure. Now let's address the numbers inside the table. 87 of what? Well, this is actually volumetric efficiency itself. It's volumetric efficiency of the engine at that particular intersection of engine RPM and engine hold. So this is then 87 of nothing. It's not any particular unit, it's percentage. It's 87%, and it tells us that 87% of the internal volume or the displacement of the engine, which is bore times stroke or the entire volume of the cylinder above the piston when the piston is at bottom dead center. And 87% tells us that 87% of this has been filled with air. Now, you would think that the engine fills its entire internal volume or displacement with air at all times perfectly. Well, actually, it doesn't. The engine doesn't breathe equally well in all operating conditions and different scenarios. And this is why we have a torque curve. And this is why we cannot achieve peak torque at 1000 RPM, for example, and that's because the engine isn't very efficient at breathing at such a low RPM. And this is again why a VE map captures the essence of engine operation, and that is because the VE map matches the torque curve of the engine. The more efficient the engine is at breathing, the more efficient it is at filling its entire internal volume, the more air there is in the engine, the more fuel we can add, the more powerful the combustion, and the more torque and power we can make. So a volumetric efficiency of 100% tells us that the entire displacement or internal volume of the engine has been filled with air at atmospheric pressure. So consequently, a volumetric efficiency above 100, for example 110%, occurs under boost. And it tells us that we have stuffed in more air into the cylinder than would be possible with atmospheric pressure alone. And this is why volumetric pressure efficiency goes above 100% under boost. So volumetric efficiency numbers essentially tell the ECU how much air is inside the engine at any particular intersection of engine RPM and engine load. By knowing the mass of air inside the engine, the ECU can then match that mass of air with an appropriate mass of fuel to achieve a desired air-fuel ratio. Now, something else you might have noticed is that VE actually falls off at high RPM. It gets reduced. Why does this happen? Shouldn't volumetric efficiency increase with RPM? Well, yes, it does, but up to a point. As you can see, it increases with RPM, but then at overly high RPM, it falls off. And this happens because at high RPM, the engine simply does not have enough time to breathe. The motion of the valves is synced to the motion of the piston. And at very high RPM, we have very high piston speeds. So the valves are open for an extremely short period of time, which means that the engine simply doesn't have enough time to ingest the air and fill its entire internal volume with air. And this is why at very high RPM, VE, as well as your torque, starts falling off. Okay, now let's see how all of this works in practice. We are in the car, I have my laptop, we're connected to the ECU, and we can follow what happens on the VE map, how the ECU follows the VE map in real time. Now observe what happens if I take this value, this 61 here at idle, we're in our idle zone, and let's change it to, let's say, 30. You can probably hear that, and you can also see it in the software. Now our RPM is hunting. We have an unstable, a hunting idle. So let's fix this because this is annoying. And as you can see, immediately our idle is restored. The question is, why did this happen? Well, it happened because we told the ECU that there is less air coming in the engine than there actually is air coming into the engine. There is more air coming into the engine than 31% of the displacement, but we told the ECU it's 31. So the ECU adjusted, it added less fuel, and as you can see again in the software, it's there again so you can see it. Our air fuel ratio starts becoming very lean as the ECU cycles through the cell. Again, we change it, and now again we have a very stable air fuel ratio. The question is, why did it start cycling? Well, it started cycling because the ECU added too little fuel. There's too much air, too little fuel, and that's a lean mixture, an overly lean mixture for idling. So the torque output from the engine becomes weaker, and the engine cannot sustain the needed RPM due to this weaker torque output. And so the RPM goes down. And this brings us back into one of the other cells, which have a correct VE input in them. So this again restores proper torque output, proper combustion. We have more torque, and then this sends us back to the incorrect cell, where again we have too little torque, so we fall down, and we have a cycle, a never-ending cycle, unless we fix the value in the table. The question that arises from all of this is, how do we know which is the correct value? Because in reality, we have no idea how much air is coming into the engine at any point in time. We don't really know how volumetrically efficient the engine is at all of these intersections of RPM and engine oil, which begs the question is, how did this map come up? Did I make it up? Did I download it from somewhere online? Where does this map come from? Well, the map actually comes from the ECU itself, and that's because modern ECUs, like my AEM Infinity right here in this forest of wires, these ECUs are really clever. So when you first set up your engine, your ECU, and tell it what kind of engine it's going to run, the ECU is asking you for some basic engine parameters. Displacement, number of cylinders, what kind of ignition system, you know, what kind of firing order, very basic stuff that you know about your engine already. And when you give the ECU these parameters, the ECU is going to spit out a generic volumetric efficiency base map based on these parameters. And in many cases, in actually the vast majority of cases, this map provided by the ECU is going to be enough to get you started and even driving around a bit. In many cases, this map is going to require only minor corrections until it is perfect. But there's more good news, because even these minor corrections to the VE map, you don't have to do that yourself either. The ECU does that for you as well by relying on this. Let me just show you. Let me just get in there. And this right here is your oxygen sensor. As you can see, it sits in the exhaust stream and basically measures the oxygen content in the exhaust stream. It's a bit more complicated. What it essentially does is that it provides a feedback to the ECU. It is telling the ECU about, very accurately, about the actual content of the air to fuel inside the engine, inside a combustion chamber. And in addition to the wideband sensor, the only other thing you need is this. And this is perhaps the most universal map ever. It's called a lambda target or air fuel ratio target map. These are your target air fuel ratios. This is what you want to run at different engine RPM and load intersections. And this very map, the very same map, is applicable, I think, to pretty much any gasoline engine out there. So the triangle of VE map, air fuel ratio target map, and wideband sensor works like this. The ECU reads the VE map, and then it injects fuel according to the values in the air fuel ratio target map. The wideband sensor then tells the ECU that it's off by a certain percentage. The ECU corrects the amount of fuel injected until the air fuel ratio reported by the wideband sensor equals the target air fuel ratio. The only other piece of the puzzle is your injector setup. You must tell the ECU the flow rate and the offset or dead time of your injectors. Fortunately, you don't have to guess anything here, as these numbers are usually supplied in the package with your injectors. Now, there is a limit to how much the ECU can correct the amount of fuel based on the feedback provided by the wideband sensor, and this amount is usually limited to 30%. In other words, the numbers in your VE table can be off by a maximum of 30%. This means that if your engine is something weird or extreme, you might be ingesting 30% more air in certain parts of the map, and in this case you'll be outside of the target air fuel ratio, and the ECU won't be able to compensate unless you properly manually adjust your VE map. Even if you have to make large manual corrections to the VE map yourself, that's easy to do as well. All you have to do is observe the lambda feedback value on your laptop as you're driving. This is telling you how much the ECU is correcting based on what's it reading from the VE map until it hits the target. Alternatively, if you don't want to use a laptop, you can use a digital dash like this one that lets you see the data while you're driving. Now let's start the engine. And we're going to observe the AFR trim value right here. Let me zoom in a bit. And this is telling us how much the ECU has to correct to meet the air fuel ratio target. And as you can see in my case, we have only minimal corrections, 2, 3, 4, 5% most of the time, and this is very much within what the ECU can do. However, if you were to see 30% minus or positive at certain RPM and throttle openings in this little AFR trim cell, then you would know that the ECU is trying to add or remove at least 30% fuel to hit the lambda target. However, as you're driving, you can see where it's happening, and then you can fix that area of the VE map until you are back within the scope of what the ECU can do. So that's pretty much it. All you really need are basic engine parameters, your injector parameters, the world's most universal map, and a wideband sensor, and you can build and fix a VE map by yourself in minutes. Isn't modern technology great?